come seek an adventure in salty old pirates, eh? Sure, you've come to the proper place. But keep a weather eye open, mates, and hold on tight, with both hands, if you please. There be squalls ahead, and Davy Jones waiting for them what don't obey.
Dead men tell now.
In 1961, Disney legend Mark Davis, the famous animator who started with Disney on Snow White, began the initial concepts for what would become the most famous and unquestionably the most popular theme park attraction of all time.
Avast there. It be too late to alter course, mateys. And there be plundering pirates lurking in every cove, waiting to board. Set closer together, and keep your ruddy hands inboard. That be the best way to repel boarders. And mark well me words, mateys. Dead men tell no tales.
Plans were on the drawing board for an expansion out past Adventureland at the bend of the rivers of America. Walt loved the city of New Orleans, with its wonderful ornate French architecture, tall tales of ghost stories, and dastardly pirate plundering.
Disneyland has always had a big river and a Mississippi sternwheeler. It seemed appropriate to create a new attraction at the bend of the river. And so Disneyland's New Orleans Square came into being. A New Orleans of a century ago when she was the gay Paris of the American frontier. In 1803, the United States wanted New Orleans for a port. In order to get it, we had to make a package deal with Napoleon. He insisted that we buy the peripheral area. So we threw in an extra million and ended up with 800,000 square miles. The Louisiana Purchase was probably the greatest real estate deal of all time. It included all of this territory from the Gulf to Canada. Total cost, $11 million. And by the way, Disneyland's New Orleans Square alone cost $15 million. But of course, a dollar went much further in those days.
Walt's team went to work on designing what would become New Orleans Square. New Orleans was the first new themed area to be built in three stories, a bottom level, a ground floor, and the top floors that would become Walt's new larger apartment and eventually his private Club 33. The first level, of the basement level as it was called, was originally to be a walkthrough of the seedy underbelly of the city of New Orleans, a wax museum starring the most deadly of all the ocean's creatures, pirates.
The first time I heard about pirates, I was animating, and I think actually Mark was, or he may have been in between jobs. But he was given the assignment by Walt, as I remember, to start off on a story which was designed to be a walkthrough.
The Wax Museum was even placed on a 1959 map as the eventual home of the pirates. This walkthrough pirates attraction was to feature scenes of famous pirates from history, legends, and realistic scenes of pirate life.
Mark did a few pirate drawings before things were brought back from New York, but Walt wouldn't look at them because he didn't want to get carried away with it at the time. So when everything was back in working order, then he started with the pirates.
Well, then we started Pirate Ride, you know, that was on the books, and so that was a real fun one too, just great fun. And all the different personalities and all of the outfits they wore and everything else, you know, I mean, everything. That was a big project, that was our biggest, really.
Mark initially did sketches of famous pirates like Blackbeard, Captain Kidd, and Captain Morgan.
Walt loved the pirates, and he could hardly stand it that he couldn't, you know, see the pirates.
You know, the atmosphere, the sets, all of it was just, you know, much fun.
Whenever Mark designs, works on a ride to design a ride, he does a tremendous amount of research and drawings. And he does one drawing after another after another. And it's like the drawings when you walk into the building and start walking up to get into the boats, and they have these drawings of the pirates from different periods. Those were all part of Mark's drawings for research for the pirates. And he does a lot of drawings with say there's one idea, but he would do five different ideas of that certain section. And he would say that Walt would always like to have a number of things to look at to be able to choose from it what he wants. And Mark told me once that a young man came in and was drawing some ideas for Walt on something, and he did one drawing, and he brought it to Walt, and he said, "Walt, what do you think of this?" And Walt looked at it and kind of frowned, and then he turned back to the young man and smiled, and he said, "It's very difficult to choose between one." And from that time on, the young man knew he should do more than one drawing.
Staying true to real pirates and actual pirate lore was soon to be scrapped. Mark Davis learned from his research that most pirates did not fight the fierce sea battles, nor participate in the incredible heroics as portrayed in famous stories. Most real pirates were nothing short of hired killers and thieves, who mostly died from venereal diseases and not at the end of a broadsword. This really took the glamour out of pirates for Mark Davis.
In fact, in the early 60s, we were going out to Walt had a new airplane, and Willie Reitherman, who had been an airline pilot, was the chief pilot, and I don't know who else was with him. They had two pilots on a Queen Air or some new airplane that Walt had, and he liked airplanes. And so a group of us were given a lunch, and we flew out there to observe where this pirate ride was going to be, and they were already tearing it out and tearing up the very first go-around on that. Most people would never tolerate, I don't know how much expense, but it could have been in the millions for all I know. Walt, when he saw a better way to do something, discard the old way. It'll pay back when we do it right.
After that, we came back from New York and brought the Small World and Mr. Lincoln. I was always sorry that they didn't bring in the cavemen, because they were fun. But so much for cavemen. But anyway, I think it's probably because we had limited space also at Disneyland, and Walt wanted to do the pirates.
But a little bird named Jose was just being born in the Imagineering Studios in Glendale, California.
Ah, aloha. It is showtime now in Walt Disney's Enchanted Tiki Room.
Julie, I think you know our fine feathered friend here, Jose, the host of the Enchanted Tiki Room at Disneyland.
Yes, I've seen him many times there.
Jose, Julie's been selected to represent Disneyland as Miss Tencennial. Do you approve?
Thank you, Jose.
Buenos dias, senorita.
You know, the same scientific equipment that guides rockets to the moon is used to make Jose and his little friends in the Tiki Room sing, talk, move, and practically think for themselves. And I guess you could call him a creature of the space age.
Jose, wake up. It's showtime.
Oh, buenos dias, senorita. My siestas are getting shorter and shorter.
Tiki Room birds were here every day, and this little bird signaled the start of the largest revolution in theme park history, audio animatronics.
You can just build it in layers. The beauty of it is, once you have that on tape and you want to modify a certain track, let's say you've got a head nod and you've layered it in there but you don't quite like it. Well, you can keep replaying that and then have that one track be able to be modified on the fly as you go. You don't have to re-record the whole thing. you can go in there and say, well, I got a gain of plus 8 or minus 2. Well, I'll just change it up a number or down a number. And when the time comes through that sequence, you have your hand on the knob and you can just tweak it up, tweak it down a little bit, and just kind of fine tune it. In a way, it's much like if you go to a big dance show, big disco dance show, and you see a big lighting board, and you see people with lighting instruments and lasers and everything is going, the smoke is going and stuff. A lot of times this will be program layers with presets. All the presets are already in there. And because you usually have a lighting guy and he's working with the disc jockey, and depending on the way the crowd's working, you can actually go in and modify the presets on the fly or modify how some of the instruments are going to respond and sort of adjust the show as you go on top of something that's already pre-recorded. So animating creatures or humans is not unlike programming lights on the fly for a disco dance.
With the great success achieved with audio animatronics, the idea of a walk-through wax museum underneath New Orleans Square was quickly scrapped.
They're already beginning to reconstruct the idea for a ride instead of a walk-through, because the walk-through, they realized, would not have nearly the high capacity that Walt would have envisioned.
Engineers at Aero Development were working on a transport system for the ride, following the success of the Small World ride at the World's Fair in New York.
As you know now, the Pirate Ride is a very high capacity ride, and there's very little weight for people, even if they've been in line a while.
We wanted to use a boat ride because we figured that is really the simplest way to move people through a ride, because don't build a mechanical vehicle if you can get away with it. You put a boat in a canal and then find a simple way to make the boat move without putting power in the boat. So the idea was you could use like water pumps in a canal. And so Aero Development came up with the idea of, we could use water pumps, and they figured out a way to do that. And then the task fell to me to design the shape of the boat and the seating and how the trough or this canal trough might work. So we built that with a deeper section in the bottom of the trough where I had guide wheels that would keep the boat from banging into the sidewalls of the trough. That meant that the water that's being pumped into the bottom of that trough would hit the wheels underneath and propel the boat very, very easily. There's kind of a flow. There's a channel that's just under the water, so you see like you're in a lake, but really there's a channel there. And they just maintain a flow through that, so the boats just kind of drift. They're quite random, and part of it is, they come down the splash ramps, so that you got a lot of very random behavior of the boats.
Mark Davis went back to the drawing board again and decided to take a less scary approach to these rollicking buccaneers of the seven seas. Mark's new pirates were light-hearted caricatures of what people thought the romantic image of pirates really were. Bright colors and very definite facial characteristics of the Caribbean were being brought to light by this legendary animator. Here are just a few of Mark's scenes that combine drunken fun, women chasing, burning, looting, and kidnapping into a fun-loving, family-friendly attraction that would become a signature Disney staple around the world.
He loved Mark's drawings of the pirates so much that he had them have open house at WED, and he had a whole wall, all of Mark's paintings of the pirates covering the whole wall. We went to the open house, and I was standing with Mark and Mary Blair and a few others. And Walt came over and he said, Alice, he said, excuse me, but he said, I want to take Alice and show her something. And he took me by the arm and he took me over and stood me in front of Mark's paintings. And he said, Alice, he said, I want you to look at these. And I said, Walt, I look at them every day. I'm doing the costumes for the show. And he said, I don't mean it that way. He said, I want you to look at the work of a genius. He said, Mark is a genius. He said, he's been able to do all these things for me. And he said, I haven't used him the way I should. He said, we're going to do some great things together. And he said, this pirate ride's going to be a smash. You know, it's really going to be a good show. And I thanked him very much. And then I realized Walt was never able to say to you directly that he liked what you did. But he knew who your closest friend was that would come and tell you real quick. So he'd go tell them, boy, you should see what Mark's doing. He's doing some wonderful things. And I really like it. And so immediately he knew I would run and tell Mark, boy, Walt sure likes your paintings in this.
Disney legend Claude Coates went to work to create the Caribbean atmospheres in which these tall tales from the Caribbean would take place.
Actually, Claude Coates did the layout. Claude was excellent at getting the most ride in the space. And Claude did an awful lot of that.
And one who I think you sometimes don't get a lot of, hear very much about. He died too long ago to speak for himself.
Claude, meet Julie Reams.
Hello, Claude.
She's Miss Disneyland Tencennial, and Claude is the Imagineer in charge of the pirate project. So will you explain what all this is about?
Well, we've been restaging this walking the plank scene, Walt. And with the shark circling below, we've got this fellow in a real precarious situation.
I feel quite sorry for your victim there.
Yes, he's in a bad way.
Claude had a lot of input on that. And Claude did all of the layout and everything. Now that he's gone, people don't give him enough credit. But he really was awfully involved in it and just did an awfully lot. He was deaf in one ear and he talked so softly. And being 6'6", you know, we'd look up there, we couldn't hear what he was saying. And Herbie would imitate Claude. He'd say, well, I had a meeting with Claude this morning and he said, and I said, yes, Claude. He went, so Chris was always imitating it. He was a kick imitating Claude. But it was hard to understand Claude because he was so darn tall and because he spoke so softly. It was just really funny, but he was a remarkable talent, very, very gifted guy.
But Claude Coates did a wonderful job in making this a sort of a suspense ride where he had this long grotto and we do go down a fall or two, you know, and have some excitement. But we go down that long grotto and then he diminishes the iris in just before you get to the end. And then when it opens up, you have this Neverland, you know, literally. You're out there in space. You don't know where you are. Well, I credit Claude for that. And that really sets you off for a start on that show that made it something very unique.
Strike your colors, you bloomin' cockroaches! Rise, thunder! We'll see you today, Davy Jones!
In fact, I don't think the one in Walt Disney World has nearly the same impact.
He just was so flummoxed by why the pirate ride was so popular. When he started to talk about it, it was so interesting because it really was sort of amazing. He would say, oh, okay, all right, here we are. We're going to get on this ride and we're going to see pirates. We're going to see what it's like to be near pirates and see what they're all about. And that's exciting. And so we get in line and we're very excited to go see this, what's going to happen to us. And we get in this boat and the water and we start on this ride through the pirate ride. And we're going around these curves and there's these wonderful props and wonderful scenery around us. And we go around this one curve and we're getting ready to, you know, we're very excited. And we go around this curve and the boat goes around the curve. And what's the first thing we see? Is a restaurant with people eating, with waiters and waitresses and lights and music. And what is that all about? What was that? We were supposed to see... But people forgive it, and he'd say, well, people just seem to forgive it. They sort of are reassured, maybe, by this thing that's happening over here. Maybe it's just something to get them on their way. So it was kind of, you know, it was always interesting to hear how John figured stuff out.
Before Pirates was built, when they were designing all this stuff, Walt would go to Carlsbad Caverns in New Mexico. So about 20 years ago or more, some kids at Coke Corner had never been to Carlsbad Caverns. I said, let's go. So Southwest Airlines had a cheap deal round trip. So we flew to El Paso, Texas, drove up 110 miles, a road that is like drawing a line, and you see the mountains way off the distance, and an hour later you're there, or an hour and a half later you're there. So anyway, we're going through the cave, and there's one spot where in the pirate ride between the skeletons and the pirate ship, where the voice says, perhaps he knows too much, he's seen the Christ threat, that whole section is in Carlsbad Caverns. Because when I first went in there, I went, you know, why is this stalactite thing like that? You know, I didn't realize it was present. So we're going through the cave, and we come around this thing, and I look, and I went, wait till you guys see this. It looks like Pirates of the Caribbean. And there's a park ranger lady in the cave, because they have self-guided tours. And she says, you mean like a Disneyland? I said, yeah, we all work there. She goes, oh, Walt Disney used to come here all the time. He was a very dear friend of mine. She says, I remember him talking about how they were designing this pirate ride, and how it would be this bayou, and how it would go into these pirates. And he said, but there's one problem. There's got to be a transition. You just can't go around a wall and go in pirates. And so a couple of months later, he came down in the cave near closing time, and he was zipped around. He found her, and he said, we figured out what we're going to do. We're going to build some Carlsbad Cavern type things, a couple of water drops. You'll get down into the retired pirates. And she goes, retired pirates? He goes, yeah, the skeletons. I thought that was a cool name for retired pirates. So then we'll go through that section. And he said, I found a place in here that would be kind of cool if we could just do that little transition to get into the live action. She says, you know, I couldn't really comprehend what he was talking about. I said, well, that sounds good to me. So anyway, that night, she says, well, you know, it's about closing time. So they're walking to the elevator. Now, Carlsbad Caverns, you walk 3.2 miles underground, you go 800 feet in the ground. If anybody has not ever been there, go. It's absolutely spectacular to go see Carlsbad Caverns. It's amazing what God built. It's absolutely phenomenal. It's natural. So they go to the elevator, and before they get up to the elevator, he stops, and she says, what's wrong? He said, is there any possibility I could spend the whole night in here by myself? And she says, well, I don't see any problem with that. She says, like, I'm going to tell Walt Disney he can't stay in our cave all night. And so she says, is there anything you want to know about the cave before I leave you down here? And he says, yeah, let's go back to the King's Palace, which is a humongous area that would probably cover all of the whole hub cleared to Small World and all around. It takes about 15, 20 minutes just to go around that room. So he says, I want to know if I can see it from the middle, from the center of the room. So she takes him out. She says, well, when they did the lighting for the place, I only know one spot you can go out in there. So they went out, and she says, now, whatever you do, do not go off where I've showed you, because we haven't explored all that. We don't know. There may be a thin area. You may fall 100 feet. We don't know. He says, oh, I won't. Trust me. I won't go anywhere where I'm not supposed to. So they go back, and she goes up and goes home. But she gets up early to go back. So she gets to the cave about 6 a.m, and she's zipping through from the mouth, zipping around, trying to figure out where Walt would be. She gets going around the King's Palace, and she looks out to the middle, and there's Walt laying on his back, his hands folded. And so she tippy-toes out up to where his head is facing her, and she goes to look over at him, and he looks up at her, and she says, oh, I didn't mean to wake you. And he says, he gets up and he says, I haven't been asleep all night. She says, well, what do you think of our cave after being in here all night? He says, when you spend a night in a place like this by yourself is when you realize the hand of God is what built this. Man in a million years wouldn't be able to make a scratch of what this room is. He says, you know, I have that place in California called Disneyland. It's nothing compared to this. But I just hope someday people will be able to go there and say, this is a neat place too.
It was then up to Disney's top sculptor, Disney legend Blaine Gibson, to dimensionalize Mark's drawings into living, breathing, life-sized pirates that would pillage, plunder, rifle, and loot.
Blaine, I want you to meet Julie Green.
Hello, Blaine.
Julie is Miss Disneyland Tencennial, and I want you to tell her all about what you're doing here.
We're working on a full-scale pirate, Julie, and I'd like you to have a look at him here.
Quite an angry-looking fellow.
Well, he has to be a tough guy. The pirates were pretty tough.
This will animate when we have it in the show, you know. He'll talk, and we'll have all kinds of body movements and things. They carry on a regular little story, you know.
Then he'll be audio-animatronic.
Audio-animatronic, that's right.
Good.
She's sharp.
She is.
But before Blaine does the full scale, he works on the miniatures. And then we got them right over here. Take a look at some of them. I take this little miniature here is taken first from a sketch. We make these sketches to figure out the types and the characters, and then Blaine takes them and puts them in dimension. Okay. Can you hand some more?
Quite real.
Now, these sketches here have to do with some of the things that are going to happen when you take this cruise through the pirate's domain. Here's one here. Here's a pirate laden with loot. He's trying to escape. He's got 1 foot on the dock and 1 foot on a rocky boat. You know, as the people go by, they see him. He's struggling and everything.
Good luck to him.
Well, he can't make it, or the show would go to pieces, you see. He has to stay there all the time and keep trying to get away.
Walt Disney himself cast the roles of the pirates to live actors and workers, whom the wet Imagineers would replicate in clay to create the full-sized pirates and buccaneers.
Of course, most of those, as I said, outside of one or two that I did, were Mark Davis's concepts. And he really had a great sense of getting the kinds of period atmosphere which would have been, you know, in the New Orleans area. Very much like they did in the movie, I think. They sort of copied that pretty much. But where we had the setup was so believable. And these guys are... Mark comes up with ideas where guys are straddle cannons and things. Well, you know, not a lot of guys' minds work that way, you know. They don't come up with just anything. And then guys getting on a boat and tottering because anybody try to step onto a boat from the shore knows what happens. And those kind of things have a humorous quality about them. And so I think if young people now in this business could only understand that there was a certain subtlety in all of that stuff that was actually believable.
Disney legend Alice Davis created some of the most elaborate costumes ever made for a Disney attraction.
When I started working on the pirate ride, doing the costumes, it was a bit of a shock to the system because dressing the figures, the feet were bolted to the floor. If they were sitting on a chair, they were bolted on the chair. And like the pirate that's on the cannon, his whole body is bolted to the cannon. His hands are bolted together holding the gun, and the elbows are bolted to the cannon. His knees are bolted to the cannon. His ankles are bolted together, and to try to figure out how to dress them and get the clothes on is something else.
We had a studio at the studio. We had one down in Disneyland, and I employed a mannequin maker by the name of Rudy Vargas, who was a wonderful man and who did a lot of bodies for the presidents and things like that. And it made, because he was a mannequin maker, it made the problem of clothing for the designers. Well, Alice Davis can verify that. On some of the pirates, we had some of the guys that insisted on doing what they know, you know, and genitalia is not the most important thing to do when you're putting clothes on a character, but they sometimes would insist on doing that, and poor Alice would come to me and say, "Blaine, could you get those guys to just knock it off? let's keep it pretty subdued, and because I can't get the clothing over this stuff. And it was a very little war we had with our guys, because they weren't doing anything in their views that was wrong, and of course it's just that they didn't get the whole picture. The whole picture is what you have to do with it, and that's who's going to work on this afterwards. What is it? What is the best course to take? And the best course isn't to just do a sculpture of a nude guy there. You know, that's not...
You left that for the presidents.
Since I was working on the costumes, I started thinking, you know, they should have more than one costume. They should have two costumes for each figure, because if something happens, there's hydraulic pipes, you know, cords that go through. And if one of those cords gets twisted and snaps, you have this terrible red oil that comes out, and you can't get it out of the fabric. I mean, it's lost. So I told them I thought we should have two costumes. And they said, oh, we don't have the time. We have to have just one costume as quick as can be. Well, you can cut two out at the same time you cut one. And so I just decided, well, I'm going to make two costumes. And so when I went to the bookkeeper to say how much material I needed for shirts and pants and all this, I would give him twice the amount I needed, and he didn't know. So I made two costumes and I hid one set. So on hats and things that if they got damaged would take a week or more to make a new one to replace it, you can't keep the whole thing shut down because of hats missing. So I made two hats for figures where it would be a problem. So sure enough, when the ride opened, everything was fine, excepting about a month and a half later, they had a fire. And the sprinklers went on, and it destroyed some of the hats, and the costumes were burned on three of the figures. So they came running to me, you know, oh, what are we going to do? We have to keep the ride closed till we get more costumes. And how long will it take you? And I said, well, if you bring me the fishing pole to put the hats on, I would be have everything ready for you in a half an hour. Well, and I showed them that I had made two sets, and they didn't know whether to hit me or kiss me, so. But the show was only closed for one day.
And it was fun. That was one of the most fun projects I ever worked on. And as I said, I had the privilege of studying characters from all walks of life, including one guy that worked at the studio that I saw very frequently. In fact, a guy that worked with me, George Snowden, a sculptor, said he knew that guy, and he said, Blaine, you better tone that down a little. It looks just like him. Well, it wasn't quite true. I'd exaggerated a bit, but when you got Harriet, people like Harriet's makeup and everything on them, you could do the same character. We did use the same character. We did. I think I did more than 30 heads there.
Well, this one next to you was used in both rides in several places.
Yeah, it's used, and it's a very, I think, a very believable head. I don't think it's anything unbelievable.
Yale Gracie, a master of illusions for Disneyland effects, and the man who, along with Rolly Crump, came up with the use of the Pepper's Ghost effect in the Haunted Mansion, designed the fantastic and sometimes too realistic fire effects for the attraction. In fact, the fire effects are so real that they are programmed to be turned off in the event of a real fire. Pirates of the Caribbean also borrowed another exciting and realistic effect from the World's Fair. The whole attraction was supposed to take place outside in the dark, but in reality was inside an enormous would-be soundstage. The effect came from the Sky Dome Spectacular, which was part of the New York World's Fair General Electric Carousel of Progress. The effect was that of making realistic clouds indoors. It made for a sense of being out in the moonlight in the Caribbean, floating through a burning town. The actual interiors and sets built for this swashbuckling adventure were true to the many concept paintings done by Herb Ryman.
Then Mark did all of the sketches of the sets, the little setups, I guess you'd say, and then Blaine sculpted them. And then Fred Jerger was excellent at all sorts of things, from miniatures to huge. And so Walt flew him down on his company plane every day from Burbank down to Disneyland so that he could do the sets. For 9 months he worked on the sets, but flew him down every day. And so Walt came in one day, and Fred had come back early at 3 o'clock to get something. And so Walt said, "Oh, you're back early." And Fred said, "Well, yeah, I needed to do whatever." And he said, "Well, how was the plane today?" And Fred said, "Well, I was in a hurry, so I drove." And so Walt said, "What do you mean?" And so Fred said, "Well, see, Fred had to drive to the Burbank Airport, park, wait for the plane, get on the plane. Then they had to take him down to John Wayne or whatever they call it now. And then they had to wait for the people to pick him up. Then they had to drive him to Disneyland and so forth." And so Fred said, "I was nervous, so I drove." And so that hurt Walt's feelings. And he said, "That's not the point, Fred." He said, "You're supposed to get on that plane, read the paper, drink your coffee, relax, don't fight the freeway." Mm-hmm. And so that was wonderful that Walt thought of his people, you know, thinking it would be an easy, wonderful way.
Disney legend Harriet Burns built an elaborate model of the attraction. Of course, Walt Disney could not wait to tell the television audience all about this new attraction, which at the time was called the Blue Bayou Lagoon.
This is what we call New Orleans Square. And here's a picture of it from the riverfront as it will look when it's finally finished. And all these little streets are going to be very intriguing, little shops and things, and people can wander around in there. And then in here, we have a special attraction. We call it the Blue Bayou Lagoon. And people are going to get on a boat here and ride through the lagoon. And then as they get around here, we're going to take them down a waterfall and take them back into the past, into the days of the pirates, you know, where the whole Caribbean area was full of pirates and they were always sacking towns and things. And you believe in pirates, of course.
Oh, yes.
So you want to see some?
Love to.
Right over here. We'll meet them.
Meanwhile, Disney legend and former animator Exotencio had just joined Imagineering, and his first assignment was taking the dinosaurs from the Ford Magic Skyway attraction and placing them along the rails of the Disneyland and Santa Fe Railroad in 1965, in an area now known as the Fantastic Primeval World.
This model shows only a small section of Disneyland's new adventure, the Primeval World. When we started to recreate the huge animals that roamed the Earth 200 million years ago, we started with these one-inch scale figures. Then we worked our way straight up to their actual sizes. Some are 22 feet tall. You know, nature wasn't creating household pets in that era. Now, to give realism and life to these prehistoric giants, we applied the art of animatronics, which give them three-dimensional animation. So now let's go back 200 million years to the primeval world. It's just a short trip on the Disneyland Santa Fe Railroad.
After his success in creating the all-new Primeval World, Exotencio was asked to join the Pirates team and came up with the first of several world-famous songs.
The Yo-Ho song, you know, the Yo-Ho-Ho and a bottle of rum, I think I borrowed that phrase, and then made a Yo-Ho, Yo-Ho, a pirate life for me.
Yo-Ho, Yo-Ho, a pirate life for me. Drink up, me hearty, yo ho. We kidnap and ravage and don't be a hoot. Me hearty, yo ho. Yo ho, yo ho, a pirate like for me. We extort, we pilfer, we bilge and black. Drink up, me hearty, yo ho. Marauding and dazzle and even hijack. Drink up, me hearty, yo ho. Yo ho, yo ho, a pirate like. flame and ignite. Drink up, me heart, yo ho. We burn up the city, we're really a fright. Drink up, me heart, yo ho. Yo, yo, ho, fire's knife for me. Billy's plunder rifle, drink up my heart is yo ho. Kidnap a rabbit, you don't give a hoot. Drink up my heart is yo ho. Yo, ho, yo, ho, fire's knife for me.
X, of course, became a lyricist in his later years at Disney. He wrote the Yo-Ho, Yo-Ho, A Pirate's Life for Me, and Grim Grinning Ghosts. That's his song, the lyrics. He's wonderful. And he's a very gifted and sweet man, a nice, nice guy. We're very good friends.
With the all-new Yo-Ho, Yo-Ho song now resonating through his swashbuckling adventure, X went on to write the script for this attraction. Not an easy task when you consider that the only pirates in Disney films were Captain Hook. And to think of it, how is selling a woman at auction really Disney entertainment? But in the end, X Atencio made quick work out of the script. And not only did he write some memorable dialogue, but he also provided the voice for several of the ride's key scenes.
Every time I go in, I always hear a different thing too, because when the fat girl's up there, and then one of the guys like says something like, "Are you selling her by the pound?"
That's my voice.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I love that one.
Weigh anchor now, you swabbies. What be I offered for this winsome wench? Stout-hearted and corn-fed,
she be a stouter by the pound?
Shift your cargo, dearie. Show 'em your larboard side.
We watch the ready.
Belay there, you fo'c's'le swab.
Watch the ready.
We watch the ready.
Avaster.
The captain is, what be I offered for this winsome wench? And, then we needed a voice from top of the bridge here, and then I said, "Well, I'll do that voice too." I said, "What may I offer for this?" He said, "Six bottles of rum." And he says, "I'd not be sponging for rum. It's gold I'm after."
"I'm not sponging for rum. It be gold I'm after. Strike your colors, you brazen wench. No need to expose your superstructure."
"Hurry it up, boy. Come on now."
Like, you know, the down ramp to the into the show, we needed a warning as you go down the ramp. So instead of calling the high-class talent back to do it, I said, "I'll give it a try." So I recorded the, "Avast there, mateys, you come seek an adventure in salty old pirates, eh?"
"Ye come seek an adventure in salty old pirates, eh? Sure, you've come to the proper place. But keep a weather eye open, mates, and hold on tight, with both hands, if you please. There be squalls ahead, and Davy Jones waiting for them what don't obey."
And that's something else I did, that using the in-house talent. If I needed an incidental voice, I'd say, "Who wants to be a pirate? Who wants to do this and do that?" And everybody's happy to do it, because when they go through the ride with their families, they say, "Hey, that's my voice up there," you know. And it's a good ego kick thing.
X made these murderous marauders into a band of simply fun-loving pirates. Harriet describes why people want to be a pirate.
"People love the idea of the booze and the guns and the, you know, it's everybody's secret desire. And look, like when they made it, quote, politically correct, you can't make it politically correct. Sure. You'd have to take everything out of it. So you just make it to a certain extent, you know, it wasn't really politically correct."
Most of the pirates were drunk, and the guests would be able to listen in on their conversations and really feel as though they themselves were witnessing firsthand what a pirate's life really was. Disney legend and voiceover superstar, the late Thurl Ravenscroft, provided the voice of many drunken pirates.
The Pirates of the Caribbean, I was many of the drunken pirates. Yo-ho, yo-ho, pirates laugh for me, now. That kind of stuff.
Along with Exitencio and Thurl Ravenscroft, veteran character actor Paul Frees stole the show by providing more than a dozen voices for the attraction.
Speak up, you bilge rat! Where be the treasure?
Do not tell him, Carlos.
Scuttle, you old cop.
No, no, por favor, no, no!
Pipe him aloft again, matey. By gum, he'll talk.
Don't be cheating. I am not chicken. I will not talk. I will not talk.
Paul was always my man. I loved to work with Paul. He was such a genius. And my first experience was on a cartoon that we had done. He was Von Drake. And Ludwig von Drake.
And we'd done a lot of things with Frees because he was Ludwig von Drake. He was the mad Ludwig.
Nice thing about Paul and what I, and my association with him, Paul would come in for a recording session and you spent the first half hour of the recording session listening to Paul tell how great he is. And then we'd finally say, okay, let's get to work, Paul. And I'd give him the script, and he would just run with it. Just one take, and he had it. But he got himself into the character. And if it was a pirate, it was a pirate. If it was a ghost, it was a ghost. But he would come up with stuff that I wouldn't dream of writing. I couldn't, and so I wouldn't. I wasn't ego enough to say, well, no, I wanted it just the way I wrote it. So he'd come up and he'd plus it in it, and he really did a good job of it.
Oh, she be a lively lassie, she were. Oh, I tell you true, it's sore I be to hoist me colors on the likes of that shy little wench.
The combined talents of so many creative individuals contributed to this attraction. New Orleans Square was opened on July 24, 1966 by Walt Disney himself. Walt was joined by the mayor of New Orleans, Victor Shiro.
It was a gala day when we officially opened New Orleans Square. We had a real jubilee, Southern style. Aboard the Mark Twain, representatives of the press and other guests got a preview of New Orleans Square as they came downriver for the opening ceremonies. The original architecture and atmosphere of old New Orleans of the 1850s has been retained. The narrow winding streets, intimate courtyards, and the iron-laced balconies are authentic in every detail. Special guest was the mayor of the first New Orleans, Louisiana, that is. After the usual dedication speeches, we presented his honor with the key to Disneyland's New Orleans. The tradition of old New Orleans add color to the streets and courtyards. The quaint shops offer treasures from all over the world. craftsmen create articles in silver, stained glass, and many other materials.
But the first time I went to Walt Disney's house was a birthday party, his, and I got there early, as I always do, and he took me out in the backyard, and there he showed me his train. Well, I had no idea that in our neighborhood we had a train that went all around the grounds, which was probably 2 or 3 acres. And Walt had done most of the work on it. And he had the cap of an engineer, and he had a barn that the place was stored in, and he had the signals, and he had everything that this train could copy from a big train. And actually, it was just a really, at that time, I didn't know it, it was the gem of an idea for a train to run around Disneyland, which he was to build. But of all the things that were in that backyard, the most interesting to me was not the train. In that shed of his, where he had all of his equipment, he had personally built, in a barrel about the size of an old-fashioned beer barrel, big barrel, he had built machinery which eventually made a minstrel dancer on top of the barrel dance in various dances. Talk about the intricacies that it took. And this is what he did for a hobby when he wasn't sitting around in the office or putting out films of one kind or another. And that was a good clue to the kind of a person he was.
In fact, one of the most innovative ideas and greatest examples of synergy was the fact that not only would Pirates of the Caribbean be a great use of space by being below the New Orleans land and in the show building, but also, for the first time since the Chicken of the Sea Boat, guests would actually get to eat inside a Disneyland ride. It would be called the Blue Bayou Restaurant. On October 31st, 1966, water flowed freely through the Pirates attraction, and the first boat cycled through the unfinished attraction's waterways.
I had some of the heads on my desk. I was painting all of them and doing their hairdos and bandanas and things like that. And so I had some of them sitting on my desk, and he would come around and look at them and criticize the, not criticize, but critique. You know, well, we should have a patch on this one's eye, or, you know, not, you know, little things.
With a larger show building, a catchy theme song, a fantastic scale model, and friendly pillaging pirates all dimensionalized, it was time to show Walt Disney, the man who they were doing this for, just how far audio animatronics had advanced in a few short years.
This is a Caribbean town of the period, and here are the pirates in here ransacking and carrying away loot and everything. As you get down here and look through that little ring, you get the view that the audience gets.
Now here, you see the pirates are dunking the mayor into the well, trying to force him to reveal the hiding places of the town treasure. The audience will be seeing this from a boat, you know. All the characters will be life-size and lifelike in their movements. These fellows have found the town's rum supplies. But they're actually more interested in what's taking place across the river. Here, their shipmates are auctioning off the town beauties. And there's the biggest bargain of all.
And then we mocked up the auctioneer scene at Imagineering. And now it's full scale. So we had the auctioneer on one side and the pirates on the other. And we rigged up a little thing, a little dolly, and pushed Walt through the scene about the same speed that the boats would be traveling. So when I went there, and then we had all recording, and we had the voices going and everything, and it was just a lot of noise. I apologized to Walt. I said, "Gee, well, I'm sorry. I don't think this is working. I just can't understand what anybody's saying." And he says, "Oh hell, Lex, it's going like when you go to a cocktail party. You tune in on this conversation, tune in on that conversation. Every time somebody goes through, they're going to hear something different." I said, why the hell didn't I think of that, you know?
I had three plaster casts of the auctioneer, and so I painted one blonde, one redhead, one brunette, so that he could pick if he wanted a Viking-looking one or a wild red-bearded guy, or if he wanted the one that we finally wound up with.
The auctioneer was the most advanced figure of his time, far superior to Mr. Lincoln, and Walt really was proud.
They did a mock-up of the pirates on the back of the shop at WED, which is now Imagineering. And we set up the auctioneer, and we had him all dressed and ready to go. And that's the only figure that Walt saw. He passed away shortly afterward, and that's the only one he saw completely dressed and working. And it was marvelous to watch him when he saw it.
We had the whole bridge, life-size, the whole thing, put into what we called our warehouse area of WED. And he came in, he saw all of that. We had everything set up, mocked up. And the people, the actual pirates that we were sending down to Disneyland, everything was done. The costumes, the everything, all of it was complete. And so he saw all of that, and he knew he had been down to Disneyland to see what Fred was doing on the sets. All that great work on the pirates, the captains, with the organ and the jewels and all of that, and the skeletons at the first Blue Bayou. He had seen virtually all of that. And then where you dump down into where the fire scene, Walt had seen almost all of it. It just wasn't installed and wasn't working.
This test run-through of the auction scene would be Walt Disney's last time working on any Disney theme park attraction.
Mark Davis knew that Walt was not feeling well, so he said, let's cheer him up. He said, I saw a bird in New Orleans that had plucked all his feathers out of his chest because he was 102 years old and he was, you know, crazy. So he said, make a funny bird like that to show Walt, and we'll put that in somewhere in the ride. So I did this whole big parrot with the, you know, quills in his chest, and I put toothpicks for quills and wires and everything else. And it was just a funny looking old antique looking bird. And it was there to show Walt when he came in for the meeting. But he looked so bad, and he was hawking and carrying on with his throat so much, we never even showed him the bird because he just didn't look well enough. We didn't want to delay him. He was going to leave and go back to Palm Springs, he thought. However, he went over to the hospital and never got out. And that was the end of that story. It was just such a shock to us, everybody.
He had seen the show pretty much complete. And we had moved on to another project by then, onto the Haunted Mansion, as a matter of fact. So it was just as though Walt was there when we had the press opening and etc. And it wasn't until the next project that we really start feeling Walt's not being there.
But he never acted sick. He was always so enthusiastic about the next project, and he was always such an inspiration in that respect, you know, that we always have all this planned, and tomorrow, you know, when we just chew the fat, when he would be in just blue sky talking, well, he had 1,000 ideas, you know. He said, we'll do another mountain. He said, we'll have a dragon in it. And he said, in fact, we can have a baby dragon. He was just spur of the moment, you know, we can even do this, and then we can do some other things, you know. He was just always.
It was kind of a shock because I worried about what was going to happen. Although I didn't know him well, but he was always kind, pleasant, and always had a smile, never rude, never curt. It was just kind of sad because he was such an icon.
Despite the enormous loss of Walt's passing, work continued on the Pirates without Walt. But his presence and his hand was in all the Imagineers did.
When Walt died, it was sort of like a bubble bursting, and people were confused. They didn't know what to do initially, and in time, they resigned themselves, okay, we have to figure out what would Walt have done if he were still alive. And they began to play to the ghost of Walt. He was such a consuming figure. Everything was done to please him, and everything had to clear his approval. So even though he wasn't there, it was as if they still had to operate that way. And for the first many years, every attraction that was worked on was one that Walt had originally approved or at least looked at. And that's when they really started running into trouble was, first of all, how do we put together Walt's ideas, how Walt would have done it, and second of all, what happens when we're out of Walt's ideas?
The clock was ticking down to the biggest expansion since the submarines, Matterhorn, and Monorail debuted in 1959. On April 19, 1967, the all-new Pirates of the Caribbean attraction debuted to the worldwide press. That's Wally Bogue as the captain of the Columbia, taking hostage members of the international press for a spectacular grand opening day celebration, complete with drunkenness, sword fights, pillaging, and a fierce battle to storm open the gates of the new attraction. Pirates of the Caribbean was an instant success. With Mark Davis's latest creation, Disneyland had now set a standard so high in theme park design that it firmly secured its position as the world leader in family entertainment for decades to come.
People commonly refer to Pirates of the Caribbean as the greatest theme park attraction ever made, and I think it's interesting that that was really the final attraction which Walt saw basically to its completion. It was sort of like the pinnacle of his theme park career because, I mean, everything works in that attraction. It's perfect on every level. And it opened a few months after Walt died, but it was basically done. He had put his handprints all over that where there's it would be very hard to screw up after that.
I think it was really the anticipation of Pirates of the Caribbean that really got to me when I was a little kid. I mean, floating in that boat with everybody, it was kind of like we're in a small world boat, and I remember as a little kid thinking that, but at the same time, it's dark, and we just came from the light out here a little while ago. There's people eating over here. There's an old man kind of rocking back and forth on his porch there with his corncob pipe and all that, but I knew the waterfall was coming. I could hear it. I could hear the water just rushing over there, and I know the skeleton was saying something about you better not come over here, you better not pass this way, you're seeking pirates. And all I knew is we were going to go down the largest drop in the world. I mean, that drop could have been 250 stories for all I cared when I was a little kid. I mean, really, it was scary. And I used to kind of cuddle up in the middle of you know, my mom and try to be like, you know, and oh, it's the pirates, it's getting, you know. And once we went down the thing, it was just so fun. And I remember it was such a liberating thing when I was a teenager that I would like look and I would go, okay, I'm not going to be scared. And I would wait for that water to splash. And it was just a little bit on your arm, but it seemed like a huge drop. And then immediately the songs would start going on and you'd be in the pirate world. And it was just amazing.
In 1971, Walt Disney World opened in Florida. Pirates of the Caribbean was not part of the original plans for the Magic Kingdom. The reasoning was there were plenty of real pirate sites in the Florida and greater Caribbean area, so nobody would want to see fake pirates at Walt Disney World. And plans were underway to build an enormous dark ride called the Western River Expedition, designed by Mark Davis.
It was a river ride, so you went in a boat. And it starts out with cactuses that are singing and buffalo singing with prairie dogs, and then a cowboy with his banjo playing, and the cows, the longhorn cows, are singing with him as a chorus. And then you get to the town, and the town drunks. And when it's got, he's so drunk, he has his horse up on the roof of the saloon. And they, there's a group that come in to try to rob the bank. And there's a guy that's in jail, and the sheriff is sitting on his horse outside the jail, and that you can see this burrow of dirt going underneath the horse of the guy escaping, digging out from the jail. And then there's the women walking their children by the saloon, and they've got their hands over their eyes, fingers in the ears so they can't hear or see what's going on in the saloon. And the medicine man with the little kids watching to see what the medicine man's talking about, and the dogs having a fight over on the other side, and a pig coming by with her litter, and all kinds of fun things all the way through. He did these horses. There was a coach robbing a coach. Stagecoach, and these horses had bandanas on along with the robbers. And there's also some Indians doing a rain dance so they could get rain, and they're up on a plateau, and it's raining on the plateau where they're dancing, but it's not raining anywhere else. But there's grooves of water coming down from the top of the plateau, like little waterfalls. And there's Indians that are very disturbed by the drunks, and the drunks are firing off guns and that, and the Indians are sitting there with their fingers in their ears with a very pained expression on their face. And there's one that is politically incorrect that couldn't be used now, but it's very funny, and it's a drunk Indian tipping his hat to a tobacco store Indian out in front. It's just the Wild West and what it was like.
Similar in some ways to Pirates of the Caribbean, guests would board boats for a trip through the Old West. But there was a small problem with being so successful. Disney World guests demanded a pirate attraction be built in the Magic Kingdom. Sequel or not, the people had to have it. And the Western River ride idea was left on Mark's drawing boards at his home in Los Angeles, California.
And Mark was very disturbed about it.
The Disney World ride opened just 2 years later. At about 9 minutes, the Disney World version of the attraction is several minutes shorter than the Disneyland original. The show building is bigger, with an extravagantly themed exterior and queue area. And once again, an idea was borrowed from the Tiki Room attraction in Disneyland. In 1963, an animatronic bird, often referred to as the Barker Bird, would get guests' attention by letting them know about the show inside.
Aloha. It is showtime now in Walt Disney's Enchanted Tiki Room. Hurry, hurry to Tiki Room. Tikis make drum go boom. Magic is happening. All the birds and flowers sing.
In Florida, a new Barker Bird was created by Mark Davis and placed outside the attraction's Spanish facade, gleefully singing, "A Parrot's Life for Me." Inside was an elaborate and air-conditioned queue area, complete with cannons and a real fort. all made for an updated attraction with more than double the capacity, but missing the Blue Bayou restaurant. Then in 1983, Tokyo Disneyland opened, complete with an identical Pirates of the Caribbean and a recycled New Orleans Square. Yes, folks, this video is actually in Japan, even though it looks like Anaheim's version of New Orleans. The old masters from the original show were brought in, and as Exitencio remembers, there was one small problem.
The Pirates of the Caribbean, for instance, you find out with what the ghost said of saying, dead men tell no tales. He said, there is no mouth on a dead person. So that doesn't make sense. That's what we're trying to do. Well, there's no Japanese equivalent of dead men tell no tales. So then they had to come up with something else. It says, well, if you're not careful, you will not pass this way again.
From its opening in 1967, the Pirates attraction remained virtually unchanged until 1987. It seemed the attraction just got more and more popular, and the line outside its doors literally snaked around in front and all the way down a corridor parallel to the Swiss Family Robinson treehouse. Traffic jams ensued, and it became clear that something had to be done. So in spring 1987, Pirates closed, and a new pedestrian bridge was built to allow greater guest flow in the area.
That line used to just stretch forever. It was just zigzag, 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 and then they'd take you down this corridor that was through these red brick arches, and man, it was just the longest, longest line ever, and then finally you'd get into the show building. I mean, when they built that bridge over the Pirates, it was just perfect, because now you had like a nice, gentle place for people to go. There used to be major traffic jams. If you were trying to get to the Haunted Mansion from, like, say, the treehouse, you couldn't pass that Pirate line. I mean, it would really just go out to the river and back. So, I mean, it was just awesome when they built the bridge. It goes right over everything. It made a really pretty kind of entryway and whatnot. And, I mean, when you're going to watch Fantasmic now, it's a great place to stand. Just right on the bridge, you get a perfect view.
And now, the Extinct Attractions Club, and me, Brian Summer, your captain through the murky waters of the Caribbean, take you on a voyage of plunder, pillaging, and high adventure aboard the Pirates of the Caribbean at Disneyland. Ah. We begin our adventure in the French Quarter of New Orleans Square. Up above would have been Walt Disney's new living quarters. It's now known as the Disney Gallery. As we go under the pedestrian bridge, we come to a plaque that honors the creators of the attraction. As we enter inside the Pirates attraction, we see boats passing by a treasure chest, overflowing with gold and gems. To our left are paintings done by Mark Davis, based on his early drawings of real, factual pirates. These are the remains of Mark's initial ideas for the attraction. A wooden dock is where we enter onto Lafitte's Landing, a dock in the Louisiana swamp known as the Blue Bayou, and named for the French pirate John Lafitte. John Lafitte was a rogue pirate in the 1800s who fought against the British and Andrew Jackson, and later became a spy for the Spanish, trying to crush piracy in the Caribbean. John Lafitte was one of the first pirates researched by Mark Davis in the early 1960s. Ah, next we board our boat into the cool night of the Blue Bayou, with its firefly lights and sleepy bayou. Past the guests enjoying a meal at the Southern Plantation House Blue Bayou restaurant. Past a lonely man, rocking back and forth on his bayou home porch, while a banjo plays in the distance. Next, we pass under a series of brick archways to reach a lone talking skull, voiced by Exitencio himself.
Ye come seek an adventure and salty old pirate, eh? Sure, you've come to the proper place. But keep a weather eye open, mates, and hold on tight, with both hands, if you please.
Then, suddenly down a waterfall and through eerie caves. These caves are actually the basement part of the attraction that was to be the walk-through Wax Pirate Museum. We travel through the basement to get to the next waterfall that will take us under the train tracks, past the berm, and into the enormous show building where the adventure will take place. Mark Davis created some ominous scenes with birds, pirate captains, drunken skeletons, and the bones of a pirate captain. And of course, the cursed treasure. None of these scenes, with the exception of the captain in the ship, exists in Florida. These were afterthoughts designed to get us through the original basement to the main show. Again, Exitencio's narration describes the cold, hard fact that crime does not pay. And we are reminded of the code of the pirates. Dead men tell no tales.
No fear have ye of evil curses, says you. Properly warned ye be, says I. Who knows when that evil curse will strike the greedy beholders of this bewitched treasure.
Perhaps he knows too much. Ye've seen the cursed treasure. Ye know where it be hidden. Now proceed at your own risk. These be the last friendly words you hear. You may not survive to pass this way again.
As we enter the show building, our first view of live pirates come into view. The pirate ship, the Wicked Wench, is seen attacking the Caribbean town. Water cannons simulate cannon fire as the audio animatronic captain signals to his crew to fire at will. This scene in Anaheim and in Florida are nearly identical, and you almost have to pinch yourself to tell where you are. Now we enter the heart of the town as it is being ransacked. The town's mayor is being dunked into a deep well and told he will be drowned if he does not reveal the location of the town's treasure. His wife is seen above telling him,
"No, no, no, don't be chicken,"
with a Mexican accent, and slams the shutter shut when the pirates fire at her.
Don't tell him, don't be chicken.
In fact, Exitencio originally had the man singing part of the pirate song with the pirate captors as he was being dunked. But this idea was later scrapped. Next, we enter a true pirate spectacle. Live women being auctioned off to the highest bidder. Pirates on both sides of the guests watch as an advanced animatronic auctioneer tries to sell us on the idea of buying a wench for a bride. Of course, he is offering us the biggest bargain, a plump female, while the men chant in unison, "We want the redhead!" Now, in the next scene, we must tell you that several changes have occurred. In the original 1967 version, we entered an exterior scene of the outside of a grand mansion. We see pirates chasing women in every balcony. And in front of us, a fat, drunken pirate who has stolen the slip of a nude woman who is cowering in a barrel. He is talking about his philosophy and, of course, letting us know he's willing to share. At the end of this scene is the biggest laugh as a fat woman is seen chasing a skinny pirate with a broom. If all of this sounds, not too Disney, well, it is. In fact, in 1997, it was all changed. To learn more, we must know that political correctness was in vogue, and a popular attraction called General Motors World of Motion had just closed. How does this relate, you ask? Listen up. Audio animatronics are very expensive, you see, and never just thrown away. Since the redo of this chase scene was to become a light-hearted look at starvation at sea, Imagineers looked to create a scene of chaos. Animatronic figures from the World of Motion's first traffic accident scene were flown from Florida to Anaheim. The horse and the man, and a few ancillary chickens, are now on hand to help support the new scene, where pirates now chase women for food. And the drunk pirate now has a chicken leg instead of ladies' underwear. As they say, that's progress. Next, like Walt said, we set the place on fire. We enter the realistic burning town scene and hear the Exitensio classic song, Yo Ho, Yo Ho. Now, this scene is again peppered with Mark Davis humor, as the lone pirate with dozens of hats on his head wobbles back and forth endlessly, one foot on the dock and the other in the boat. Next, we find a few lonely prisoners who look to be telling no tales anytime soon, as the fire has almost reached them and will surely kill them. But being a Disney attraction, Mark Davis has again injected a funny moment into a life or death scenario, as a scruffy puppy dog holds the key that would lead to freedom. And now, the show takes us out with a real bang, as feuding pirates have a drunken gun battle on top of powder kegs full of explosives. Bring up the audio. And, as Walt promised, we go up the waterfall to get out of this mess. Next, our boat gently drops us back off through the queue area and back home to the calm waters of the Blue Bayou Lagoon.
It's important to note that in Florida, the bottleneck and constant bumping of the boats was eliminated with the Mark Davis new ending scene. We travel past a kidnapping with gunfighting pirates and simply exit our boat and travel up a Goodyear speed ramp to the exit.
The pirate film, I thought was very good. I think they could have cut about a half an hour out of it, of the battle scenes, because I saw the same man fly through the air about six times.
With the success of the Pirates of the Caribbean film, Disneyland once again closed the Pirates attraction in March of 2006 to add in characters from the pirate film.
Now we have a whole generation of kids who have grown up with the movies and the DVDs and know those characters better than they know our theme park characters. So when they come to Disneyland or Walt Disney World, they go on our Pirates and they say, where's Jack Sparrow? Where's Captain Barbossa? On and on and on. So what we decided to do is not change Pirates of the Caribbean at either Walt Disney World or Disneyland, but enhance them by adding some new characters and scenes from the movie that supplement what's already there.
In June of 2006, the Pirates once again set sail with the help of familiar characters from the film.
You tell tales, so says I. It's Captain Sparrow and a fortune in gold.
It's the treasure map for sure, and no mistake. And by thunder, that scoundrel Captain Jack Sparrow will never lay eyes on it. Captain Jack Sparrow's face, when he hears tell, 'tis only me what's got the goods. I'm studying the map.
From the stills from the film, you can see he's got three or four different colors of dreadlocks. He's got some textured black hair. He's got a lot of fine, wispy hair. And it took three or four iterations of this wig to get it so that it finally spoke his character.
I think they've done an incredible job putting this guy together. And seeing him, especially up close like this, it's a little more than spooky. I mean, that's it, isn't it? I mean, it's Captain Jack. No, it's really astonishing. Their work is amazing. Fine details, the movement, the gestures, the movement of the eyes is staggering.
40 years after they set sail, the Pirates are still proving that while dead men tell no tales, guests find a treasure trove of adventure with this swashbuckling crew of rogues from the Caribbean.